It's a joy to be with you today. It's a joy to share with you the beauty of God's Word. When you hear the gospel lesson today, when Jesus says that you will never be abandoned, that God will always be with us, that He will never leave us by ourselves. These are beautiful words of assurance, and I hope they touch your heart and gladden you the way they do to me and my family. It was a joy to gather with some of you in person last week at the J.L. Davis Funeral Home when we gathered to celebrate Mother's Day. What a joyful time, and how delightful to social distance the choir and have them stationed there to lead our singing. It was a beautiful and joyful time, and I want to thank you all, and I want to thank everyone who made that possible. It was really very special. We have another such opportunity to look forward to in just a few weeks on May 31st, which will be the Festival of Pentecost. That's right, we're already at the sixth Sunday of Easter. That means we have two more to go for the octave to be full, and the final one will be the Feast of Pentecost, and it will be a joy to gather again at the J.L. Davis Funeral Home in the parking lot, where we're going to celebrate the Feast of Pentecost in some ways that we could not celebrate were we to be inside. That's all I'm going to say at this point. But we have some special things planned. I hope that you'll mark your calendar now for 10:30 on the 31st and plan to be there. I'd also like to let you know, just to go ahead and put the information out there, the governor has said that under certain restrictions, we can resume in-person worship inside the sanctuary. In consultation with the church council, and in consultation with guidelines that the Synod has provided for us, and also from the ELCA churchwide, our church council has decided that we will give that a try starting on the first Sunday in June, which is June the 7th. So you have at least three more Sundays that you can tune in early on Sunday morning and find the video when you're pouring your first cup of coffee and have church as early as you would like. But I will caution you, once we return to in-person worship, we will still offer a recording, but it won't be available until probably later that day. So it won't be available first thing in the morning. We're going to record the live worship that we offer, and we pray that that will still be meaningful to you in your life of faith, albeit not quite as convenient for some of you who are early risers and like getting the video at 6 or 7 in the morning. So I apologize for that, but that is hopefully our goal going forward. We'll be live streaming at some point so that you can tune in live online to watch the service. And until that time, we'll be recording what we do inside the worship space, inside the sanctuary, and then that'll be posted to our website and posted to the YouTube channel. So, lots of exciting things happening. Also, next week, I'll have some more information for you and ask you to check your inbox for your email, because I'll whip out my cell phone, which is currently across the street in the office, and I'll show you a picture of the Tithely app, and you'll be able to go online when you get your email at the end of next week and start building your profile on your own phone through Tithely. And then if you'd like to give electronically, all of that can happen right through the app. It's exciting, it's new, and it means that anyone watching our videos far and wide, we can send, if you let the church office know and you're not currently a member, but you'd like to be affiliated, contact our church office, and we'll be glad to send you that email so that you can set up your profile as well and begin your online giving, and also stay connected, because there are all sorts of other exciting things that you'll updates you'll be able to get through that app. So it's a really exciting time for us as church. We begin each week at Easter with our standard greeting: Alleluia! Christ is risen. Alleluia! He is risen indeed. Let us pray. Gracious and almighty God, we give you thanks for the perfect gift of Jesus. We give you thanks for this Son of yours who came to make us whole and to give his life to set us free. We know, Lord, that in the last week there are many things that we have failed to do, many things that we should have done differently. In many ways, big and small, we have all fallen short. And we pray for your mercy and forgiveness. We pray that you would wash us and cleanse us clean. Hear our confession and accept our contrite heart. Help us to be made whole in your eyes. And help us to know that the extraordinary gift of Jesus on the cross and raised from the dead brings to us exciting words of pardon and life. And so we give you thanks for making us pray that you would continue to stir in our hearts and guide us each day. Amen. My friends, as a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have a beautiful opening hymn. It's hymn number 618. If you have your red hymnal, guide me ever, great Redeemer. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship is unknown. This I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, He is Lord of heaven and earth. He does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor, he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him. Though indeed, he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, 'For we too are his offspring.' Since we are God's offspring, We ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which all the world will be judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Holy God, as we pause now to meditate upon the beauty of your word, we pray that you would be alive in our hearts and stir in our hearts face uncertain times and uncertain days ahead might face them with hope and with optimism, just as the apostles faced uncertain days in the face of unfailing and relentless persecution. Help us, knowing that we are not persecuted, but that we are somehow stymied. Help us to make our case with love and hope. And we ask this in Christ's holy name. Amen. I am so excited for all of you watching from home who would normally be here on a Sunday morning, because all of this crazy static in my microphone makes you feel right at home. You hear it and you say, I'm there. It's just like smelling his aftershave. I'm there. Well, I don't really use aftershave, but sometimes I have to put something on my shave too close. It does smell nice. I want you to feel at home. God wants you to feel at home. And who knows? I mean, well, we all know. You are at home. That's why you're watching the video. So, I hope that you have filled your cup of coffee. I hope that breakfast is almost ready, because you know you really shouldn't eat before church. You should always wait until afterward. Otherwise, there's just not nearly as much anticipation, and you might fall asleep during the sermon. And I would hate for that to happen. Although the good news is, when that happens at home, you can hit rewind and experience it again. And you can keep trying until you're awake through the whole thing. Okay, so all joking aside, as I said in the prayer preparing for this message, you and I know that we live in these crazy times. We know that the one thing we don't know is what's going to happen tomorrow. I mean, you might know. Maybe tomorrow you're going to get up and cut your grass. Maybe tomorrow, for the first time, you're going to be going back to work. You haven't been there in a while. Maybe tomorrow, for the first time, you're going to go to Kohl's and look for clothes for your children, because they haven't stopped growing in the 2 months we've been home. And even though you can order things online, you just have to keep paying shipping and sending it back. And it's so much easier to sort of go and size it up and say, oh yeah, I think that'll fit. Now, there are other things that you might be doing too. Later on this evening, I personally am looking forward to some very important Chinese food from my favorite Chinese restaurant in Westminster that we're going to take home and eat. But it's so exciting, because literally we started the quarantine, the lockdown, with that Chinese food, knowing that we were going to be locked down for a while. So to end it with that on a Sunday night dinner, what a gift. And I can almost taste the deliciousness in my mouth. It is wonderful. But enough about the food. Pastor Hembrock always reminds me, I talk a little bit too much about that sometimes. But you see, food, like Jesus, is something to love. And in the second lesson today, we hear these important words that Peter shares in 1 Peter 3:13, and then 1 Peter 3:15. Always be prepared to make a defense of the joy and hope that is within you. When I started seminary, and it's hard to believe that just this past week I celebrated 10 years of graduating from the now defunct Gettysburg Seminary, now United Lutheran Seminary. It's hard to imagine 10 years ago I was in that chapel, and they were playing lots of beautiful hymns, and we received our diplomas, and were told that we could now venture out into the world and take on the forces of Satan and death and shame and all of that, with joy and hope in our hearts. But you know, I thought back this week to the beginning of my seminary journey. Seminary, when I was there, started with a summer Greek class that started in August. And it was rather intense for first-year students, and we were all there together in that summer Greek class. And we formed a bond with each other because of that intense time that we spent just with each other in that summer Greek class. And it was really a fascinating time, learning Greek, getting to know the other folks in my class. And one of my fellow students, Mary, was also like myself. She was not straight out of seminary. She was not straight out of undergrad. She had also lived life a little bit, and she already had a couple advanced degrees, and actually was a college professor for public speaking. A delightful do it with gentleness and love. Apologetics classes introduce you to great writers like C.S. Lewis in his wonderful book, Mere Christianity, in which he describes for us the myriad of ways that we might come to know who Jesus is, but the extraordinary way in which all of those paths lead us to one really important conclusion, that Jesus really is the Son of God. And that God's love for the world was poured out in Jesus, and in this one man who was crucified and raised from the dead on the third day, the entire world can be transformed. That each and every one of us, in hearing this story, we may react to it in a different way. We may even take a more circuitous or perhaps a more rapid path to get to the ultimate goal. But however it may work in our lives, God is at work through Jesus, drawing the world into himself. And in the process, he is busy trying to heal everything that's broken. He is in the same process trying to help us all grow into the full potential of who God created us to be, to lead lives worthy of the gospel. I spent 10 years from the time I left being an undergrad at the now defunct Western Maryland College until I entered the now defunct Gettysburg Seminary. 10 years, I worked at several different jobs, and I never really failed. But the problem was, I never felt like I had achieved anything either, because I wasn't doing what God wanted me to do. And I wasn't living up to the full potential of what it was he had put inside of me, in my mind, and in my heart. He had given me words and wisdom in a way that I could come to people and speak with them and share with them the extraordinary hope that I find in Jesus, the extraordinary hope that you find in Jesus. But I wasn't doing that. I was spending my days either in an insurance company or in a law firm, fiddling with a lot of paper. Some days there were those George Costanza moments where people walked by and you want to look busy, so you just paddle the piles of paper and you shuffle them around and they think you're really working hard. But the truth is, it's a Henry David Thoreau moment instead, when he said, "Most men lead lives of quiet desperation." Right there, that's where I was, leading a life of quiet desperation, because I was not out making the testimony that God wanted me to make with my life. I was not out sharing with people the joy and hope that Jesus Christ had put in my heart. Now, that's not something, perhaps, that everybody can do the way I do. You're not going to go to seminary. You're not going to become a pastor. But the truth is, in leading your life, in everything that you do, you and I have these opportunities that come to us. And they're in the most interesting of moments, when people will turn to us because they're not sure where else to turn. And they need to hear about the depth of God's love for them. They find themselves, perhaps like a lot of people right now, perhaps maybe some of you watching right now, at home and scared. You're not sure what the new week will bring. People in Maryland, at least, will be out moving around a little bit in most of the jurisdictions. And while many of us will enjoy our liberty and freedom restored, we also have to be cautious, because we don't know the people we interact with who might be a carrier, who might also have something even worse than COVID that we haven't even thought about. So we have a lot on our minds. But the truth is, the most important thing that we must have on our mind at all times is how much God loves us. Did you hear the gospel lesson when Jesus said to his disciples, "I'm going to be going away from you, but you will not be abandoned"? Abandoned is a horrible word. Abandoned. You think about people in stories when you hear that word, abandoned. And who has been abandoned? People on the side of the road. We think of a story that Jesus told of a man who was on a road to Jericho, and he was beaten and robbed and abandoned and left to die. And when we hear that word abandoned, we think of that story. Or perhaps you think of other stories. Perhaps you're a history geek like I am. And you think about some of these stories of the westward movement and expansion in America, when people were going west. And it wasn't necessarily necessarily people who were abandoned, but their priceless possessions. They found themselves in wagons trekking across an expanse of terrain, and they weren't sure if they would ever get to the other side. And along the way, they had to take things out of the wagon and lighten the load. And so the prairie was littered with all sorts of needful and useful things that had been abandoned. Chests of drawers, trunks, dishes, extra clothing and blankets. Things that could really come in handy once they arrived at their destination. But if the wagon was too heavy once they got to the Rockies, if the horses or the oxen couldn't continue to bear the load, they had to lighten it somehow. And so there they were, abandoning their precious possessions, on the way to a dream, a new life. Sometimes you and I have to abandon things in our lives, because sometimes we hold on to garbage. Now, I know that I'm the chief sinner, and I'm preaching to myself and letting all of you listen. I feel that my house is filled with treasure. But then there's also the barn. And then there's also the shed at my parents' house. And there are several boxes on my parents' attic. And because I am so overwhelmed with treasure, my wife has not been able to bring a good portion of the treasure from her parents' house when we were married 6 years ago. So there we are, already overwhelmed with things. And why is that? Because I haven't been able to bring myself to abandon some of them, to let go, to move on, and to understand that as we move toward a new life, new things will surround us, and old things won't matter as much. There's some things we'll still prize. For some of you who watched my video on Maundy Thursday, it was filmed in my dining room at home. Abby helped me set the table with fine china. The silver that we put on the table, that was a gift from the Goldsteins after they passed away. Their son gave us their silver plate. There was a small pickle caster on the table, silver-plated, and it belonged to my Aunt Letty and my Uncle Bill. And before that, it belonged to my great-grandmother. And Uncle Bill knew as a child how much I loved pickles. And so before he died, he told his wife, my Aunt Letty, that someday that should come to me. And it still has the handwritten note inside in Aunt Letty's handwriting, explaining that story. And then behind me was a corner cupboard that's been in that house that we live in since the house was built in the 1870s. And it belonged to a family that lived there for several generations. And since they adopted us, it wasn't abandoned when Bobby sold us the home and moved back to Rome and Frederick. Instead, we adopted that cupboard and we were grafted in. So you see, some things are abandoned and other things are cherished. And it's a really interesting journey that we go on, trying to figure out what to abandon, what to let go, and what to hold on to. Well, it's not really as hard as I make it sound. Hold on to Jesus. Because Jesus holds on to you. Again, he said in that gospel lesson today, I'm going away, but I'm going to send my Spirit. I'm going to send an advocate. Not just someone who will watch over you. Not just someone who will guide you to a degree. But someone who will advocate for you. The sad truth is, in just the last 2 weeks, a very dear friend and a cousin of mine have both gone to the hospital. We just found out the cousin today. He just found out yesterday he has a brain tumor. He's going to have surgery on Monday. His wife is very upset because she can't be with him. And no members of his family can be there with him. My other friend who had a stroke a week and a half ago is doing well, and I thank you for your prayers for him. But it's been breaking his family's heart that they couldn't be with him. He had to go on this journey in the hospital, and they had to trust in all the medical professionals to continue to do their best, but they weren't there to advocate. They weren't there to share in the small joys and triumphs of when he was able to first move limbs that wouldn't move before, when he was able to formulate words and sounds together and make them come out of his mouth. And those are small joys to celebrate that well up our hearts and our eyes. eyes with tears when we're there. And then we share with nurses and doctors, and we advocate for more treatment, for more therapy, for more ways in which that life can be just enhanced. But they can't be there to do that. But Jesus says to you and I that he sends an advocate. The Holy Spirit will come to us, and the Holy Spirit is not just there to watch over us like a guardian angel and try to protect us. He's literally there to advocate also on our behalf with God. He pleads our case. And he invites and calls to us to make the right choices. And at the same time, God listens to that advocate who speaks on our behalf when we fall short, when we fall down. And in other ways, too, it's not just about our sin. It's also about our fears and our failings. Not just feelings, but our failings. Because, you see, sometimes fear can cripple us, and we fail to act in certain ways. We fail to speak in certain ways. We fail to do certain things because we're scared of what that might look like. We're scared of where that might take us. And we're not sure about the unknown. My friends, I'm here to tell you the great news that you and I have is that we're not on this journey by ourselves. You're not home. You may be at home without another person in your house or your apartment. And you may have now spent weeks like that, but you've never been alone. I remember a couple of years ago, I was asked to officiate a funeral for a young man who was, I think, probably not yet even 30 years old, who had taken his own life. He had children. He left behind a wife. He left behind a grieving mother. He left behind an uncle who was an ordained pastor. And I wasn't quite sure why he couldn't do that funeral. But when the funeral home called, I said, sure, I'll do that. And the day that we all gathered in the funeral home, I knew the one question that haunted so many people there. It wasn't the question of why did he do it. They already knew. They knew that he had felt life was closing in on him. He felt like there was a lot of brokenness in his life that could just never be healed. But what they worried most about was the bigger question that you and I sometimes wrestle with. Where was God in all of that? Where was God that this young man would be so far out on the end of that ledge and he would jump off, that he would take his own life, that he would be so far out on a limb, I guess I should say, that he would feel like he needed to just end his life? That's again a question that I wasn't fully able to address for them. But in a more important way, I underscored something else that I believe firmly with all my heart, and I hope that you will too. In that unbelievable moment of brokenness, when that young man was out literally by himself somewhere with no one else around, he wasn't alone. It would have looked like he was alone if it were a TV show or a movie. To any casual observer driving by, walking closely, they might have thought that he was alone. But I don't believe he was alone. I believe the advocate was there pleading, trying to help him. Trying to help him make the right choice. Trying to help him find the strength inside that he needed. But for whatever reason, he couldn't get there. And so then the advocate changed directions. And he pleaded with God. And he said, Lord, have mercy on this young man. Have mercy on this son of yours who has nowhere else to turn. Lord, have mercy on his family. Help him to find an ultimate healing. And at that moment when he thought all things were over, there was God to receive him. Because the advocate had walked along as far as he could and stayed with them until that other moment when God, with his own scarred hands, Jesus reached out and said, "You are my own, and lo, I have loved you all along, and I will not abandon you." The world around you may seem that there's no place for you, but I have a place for you. And if your grief and your hurt and your pain are so great, come to me, my weary one, and I'll give you rest. And so, of all things for people to be worried about, the one thing I believe with all my heart is that he did not die alone. He died fully enfolded in the arms of God. And his family had the opportunity when they left that place that day to be enfolded in God's arms as well. They had the opportunity that you and I have each day when we wake up in the morning and we open our eyes and we're not sure what the day will bring, right? And we're not even sure. I don't know. Some days now, I'm just like, what day is it? I know it ends in D-A-Y, but which one? And then, you know, I have to like look at my phone to see what the date is because it's like the 87th day of the 47th month or whatever. I mean, all these days are just incredibly long, and they're incredibly grueling, some of them, and taxing and draining. And yet, even on the worst, what is it we know? That we're not alone. That in our struggle and in our fear and in our own desire to be free from encumbrance, God is with us. He has not abandoned us. We have never been abandoned. He has remained with us, and he continues to strengthen us for the journey. And you see, that's the joy and the hope that I try to proclaim every chance I get. People can find themselves trapped, bogged down, mired even, in something that they didn't cause and they didn't ask for. But even in those uncertain and unknown circumstances, the one who is known to us and the one to whom we are known is with us. I could have made a lot also about that first lesson, that first reading. I just love to say the word Areopagus. It's a really fun Greek word. And it's sort of like an open-air law court kind of a place, but there were all those inscriptions on the different altars and tables that were in that area. And Paul goes up to the one and says, it's an unknown God. Now, he had to do that. Again, if you're going to be an apologist like Paul, if you're going to go to people you've never met before and tell them about Jesus, number one, you have to know about Jesus. Number two, even more importantly, you have to know a little bit about the people you're trying to talk to. And Paul knew that he was in this Greek city, and those people had no idea, other than the fact that maybe there were some Jewish merchants in their city, they had no idea about the Hebrew God. They had no idea about the promise of the Messiah. They had no idea what it meant that God had entered into human history, that he had called one man in ancient times named Abraham to go to a far off place. They knew none of that. Paul had none of that to fall back on. And he looked around, and he saw probably lots of other gods from the pantheon and perhaps other gods from other places that the Greeks had, like the Romans, had brought in. Right there they were. And then he sees the one that matters most, the altar to an unknown God. He says, now I have something I can work with. And he goes out among the people and he says, people of Athens, listen to me. You have this altar inscribed to an unknown God, but I tell you, he is known. And moreover, it is not just that he is known. He has entered into human history. He has transformed the world by giving his son, by taking on our form, by being put to death and raised on the third day, and by then transforming and renewing the entire world. Wherever he may go, and wherever we take the word of who he is, Paul was able to look with himself with gentleness and love. He made a defense. repentance and the joy and hope in Jesus that lives inside of him. And I pray that you can do the same. Because you and I both know, right now, there are a lot of folks who need to hear about the joy and the hope. We've been living in a gray world. We go into public places and people are covering the mask. And we say to ourselves, this ain't the America I knew. No, it's not. But it's the America we're going to know for a little while. And we have two choices whenever things like this happen. You can be bitter or you can get better. We want the world to get better. Your bitterness doesn't really help. Trust me, I've tried it a long time in my life. It has never helped. But getting better, staying focused on what lies ahead, the time in the not-so-distant future, when numbers will indicate that we won't need to wear the masks everywhere we go, and that people will not have to live in perilous fear that will cripple them and hobble them. You and I are people of hope. Jesus Christ was put to death, he was raised from the dead, and in another week we're going to celebrate the fact that he ascended into heaven and makes that place for us. And because of that, we have this hope that's inside of us. And the world around us needs that hope. So my friends, hold fast to it. Proclaim it with gentleness and love. And know that as you do, you proclaim the glory of the risen Christ and the beauty of his love and mercy for a fallen world. Amen. Our hymn of the day is a beautiful hymn, number 628, Jerusalem, My Happy.
Thank you.
friends, let us pray for the church and the world and all those who need God's mercy and grace. Almighty God, we give you thanks this day for the exceeding joy and hope that we find through your Son Jesus. We who live in such uncertain times, we give you thanks for his constant presence, for his life that fills us, and the strength that enfolds us, and the peace that pervades us. Help us, Holy God, to be always on guard for the opportunities that we may have, and be prepared with gentleness and hope, with gentleness and love, to speak of the hope and the joy that lives within us because of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, we thank you for the church. We thank you for those who would have graduated this week from United Lutheran Seminary to embark upon a new vocation, those who would enter into either the ministry of Word and Sacrament or the roster of those who do work, those who are ordained service as deacons. We give you thanks for those who raise up to labor in your vineyard, and we pray that you would help them all to be faithful. We pray for our bishops, Bishop Eaton and Bishop Gold. Help them in all things to be strengthened and to be faithful, so that the joy and hope that wells up inside of them may continue to lead and guide our church through uncertain and perilous times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you, O God, for our church council. And even though our Sunday school has not been able to meet for the last 2 months, we thank you for those who continue to pray for our children and our young people of our community, and those who continue to reach out to them and try and help them hear the word, the life-giving word of God, who is relentless in that one message of his unfailing love for all of his children. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are sick. We pray for those on our list of the sick. And we pray for those that we know either out loud or in the silence of our hearts. For Stephen, David, for Richard, for Paul, for Joyce, for Donnie. May your healing mercy be poured out upon them. May your strong and mighty arms give them the strength and the courage they need for each day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, we pray also this day for all those who are working night and day to keep us safe. For all those who work in labs, in the hospital, in the doctor's offices, nurses, technicians, and doctors, and all sorts of folks who have specialties and special jobs that we can't even begin to comprehend. But they do it selflessly to keep us well, to make sick people better. Watch over them, guard, guide, and protect them. And we pray also for those who look after public safety, for all the members of our armed forces serving at home and abroad, especially those members of National Guard who were called up to special and specific duties in certain states. We pray in a special way for the police department as they have just finished celebrating National Police Week. We celebrate with the fire department and the EMTs and emergency first responders who show up when life is difficult for all of us. Watch over them, guard, guide, and protect them, and bring them safely home to those who love and wait for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Holy God, that you would watch over us. Help us to be faithful in all we do. Help us to be, as Christians, joyful, even in uncertain times. Help us to be beacons of hope and light to a world that struggles with darkness. We offer these prayers through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our Lord taught us to pray in a very special way. Will you join me now? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, I want to thank you for being a part of our worship today. I want to thank you for your faithfulness in supporting the ministry of this church. And as you prepare to go about your week and see what new and exciting developments may unfold, I invite you to be optimistic. I invite you to be a people of hope. I invite you to be a people who are not paralyzed by fear, but rather by cautiously making good choices each day. Prepare yourselves for a new chapter that will bring us more engagement with one another and more opportunities to be together, even if it still involves social distancing. May the blessings of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you, remain with you always, and keep you in His grace. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 883, All People That on Earth Do Dwell, a lovely rendition here from Mr. William Bowles.